Good morning and welcome to our weekly Zoom worship service. We'd like to begin our service by acknowledging that the land on which our homes and our church were built was not uninhabited when European settlers arrived here with ideas of conquest and ownership. For those of us who live in Moscow, Pullman, and other nearby communities, we live on the ancestral homelands of the Nimiipuu, called Nez Perce by the French-speaking traders, the Palouse and the Shichumsh, called the Coeur d'Alene. If you're joining us from another place, I encourage you to discover who inhabited or moved through the place where you now live in the times before colonization and genocide, and where they are now. We pause and remember that we live on ground that is sacred, ground that was stolen, ground that cries out for justice and for responsible stewardship. May our remembering help us to find the courage to do our part to restore wholeness to the earth and all her peoples. Now, let us join our voices together for our words of welcome, unison chalice lighting, and sung affirmation. Whoever you are, wherever you have come from, whatever your beliefs, whomever you love, and however bumpy your life's journey, know that you are welcome here. We hope that everyone has a chalice or a candle to light and something to light it with. Let's join together and light our chalices together.
Hello from the Gibbler family, Marissa, Avi, and Loie. In the light of truth and the warmth of love, we gather to seek and seek to share.
Good morning, everyone. It's so good to see you today. When people are going through hard times, their religious community holds them in love and in care, companioning them and bearing witness to their suffering and to their resilience. I would argue this is perhaps the most important justification for our existence as a church. When a community is very small, the connections between people occur naturally, and if orchestrated at all, revolve around matriarchs and patriarchs, church leaders who make sure everyone is cared for. At a certain point, it helps to have a minister come on board, someone who can be available full time. But a minister can sustain supportive relationships with a maximum of about 150 people at a time. So a lot of churches stall out, just a little bit bigger than that, with people falling through the cracks and leaving the community at about the same rate that newer folks show up to join. And that's where the UUCP was when I arrived. I remember during my candidating week, Jerry Grabowski asked me about the people who fell through the cracks, and I told him, if I have anything to say about it, that won't happen on my watch. I'm smart enough to know, though, that I would need help holding the pastoral ministry and patching the cracks. So I began a conversation with the care team about creating additional programs to provide pastoral support. We started with a visiting program to ensure that our homebound elders felt supported and loved. And then in 2018, we moved forward with creating a pastoral ministry team. 14 people completed an intensive multi-week training program. Now, some of those folks have moved away or chosen to pursue other interests, but the folks you're going to hear from today, as well as Melissa Franchik, who wasn't available to be interviewed, have worked ever since to ensure that anyone who has wanted or needed just a little extra love and listening has gotten it. I am beyond grateful to each and every one of our pastoral care team members for their contributions to our ministry. And my hope is that by giving them the spotlight today, you'll all be reminded that your religious community is here for you and that you are always held in love. Let's begin now by singing There's a River.
Thank you, Ginger, for that great story and the lovely sentiment for the week ahead. So just as we do every Sunday when we're together in person, we've set aside this time to invite you all to engage in the practice of generosity. For those of you who can make a financial contribution, the options for doing so are on your screen. You can either copy down the information you need or just go to our website to make your donation. And the web address has been posted to the chat. Those of you who are newer or visiting from another part of the country might not know that we typically give away all of the cash from our Sunday offering to local charities whose missions align with our values. We call this program the Month of Sundays. When a month has five Sundays, as this month does, the fifth Sunday is used for a special collection. Today's fifth Sunday collection will benefit Sudan Medical Relief, which was founded and is run by Dr. Jill Seaman. Dr. Seaman grew up attending the UUCP, and it helped inspire her life's work. If you donate online, you can choose from the drop-down menu where you'd like your money to go. And if you're mailing or dropping off a check, just indicate in the memo line whether it's for Month of Sundays or for the general fund. Now, in the spirit of love and for the continuing work of this church, we will take some time to practice generosity together while the offertory is played.
Ahead and your miles and miles. that I am bigger and stronger too, maybe. But none of them will ever love you the way I do. It's me and you, boy. And as the years go by, our friendship will never die. You're gonna see it's our destiny. You got a friend.
That was utterly delightful. Thank you. Let's enter now into a time of meditation with this reading called Prayer for Healing by my colleague Jane Ellen Malden. Torn and confused, lonely and enraged, I greet the new day with suspicion. Spirit of life, show me the gate to healing. May I find in my hands the tools to craft a way through the pain. When those tools fail me, may other hands reach out. Let me welcome them and know them as your hands, gently holding me, keeping me from collapse, shaping me, and molding new strength until I am ready to try again. Amen. Let's rest in the silence together. Today, what you'll be seeing are some interviews of our, that was truly splendid, that was amazing. It was such a gift for me. I interviewed the members of our pastoral care team, and I asked each of them the same three questions. What you're going to see today are just brief excerpts. I want you to know that their answers were rich and kind and lovely, and you can actually watch the entire unedited videos, bloopers and all, on the UUCP website. But for now, let's begin by introducing the amazing humans who share the pastoral ministry of this congregation, who help weave the love that holds us all.
Greetings, I'm Rodney Fry, part of the pastoral ministry team at the UUCP, and honored to be part of that team.
I'm Elizabeth Berlinger, and I am part of the lay minister care team, also part of the care team and some other things.
Hi, I'm Fran Rodriguez, and I'm a member of the lay pastoral team. And I wanted to introduce myself to the congregation.
Well, my name is Molly Smith, and I am, in fact, part of the lay pastoral ministry team.
My name is Leanne Parker. I'm a longtime UU member, and I am the newest addition to the pastoral care team, functioning mostly with respect to animal-assisted types of pastoral care.
I am Patricia Jessup, and this interview is for the lay pastoral minister team.
But you are also?
Oh, I'm also the lead facilitator of the small groups, and I'm on the welcoming committee.
We're starting by being honest about what the last year has been like. So what's been the most challenging thing about the last year for you?
I was thinking of Elizabeth Barrett Browning's poem, How Do I Love Thee? And I was thinking of how many worries do I have? Let me count the ways. I've just worried about so much this year. My children, both of my kids are involved with theater, and so naturally they were unemployed all year.
Well, in the beginning, it wasn't a challenge because I'm an introvert and I loved, you know, being able to stay in a little small space. But as time went on, I realized how lonely I was. I missed meeting with in-person service. I missed the dynamics, the laughter, the children. I missed being hugged and giving hugs.
The hardest was that all my volunteer work was gone. All of the things that I did at church, where I met with people directly, it was impossible. My volunteer work at Crittman as a lay chaplain was impossible. Just getting together with friends for a long time was impossible till we figured out we can actually meet at a trailhead and at least walk together on the mountain.
A lot of things are getting really old, but for me, the worst part is this world is not an ideal world for the hearing impaired. When people wear masks, I like to take it off to speak to me because I can't hear them when they're muffled. And proximity is key. Staying 6 feet away is not anywhere near as good as staying 3 feet away.
The most challenging thing for me has been the lack of the ability to meet in person. I do Zoom because that's the nature of where we are. But I am definitely one of those who is completely Zoomed out. And I just long for real connection with other people and being in space together.
Well, we've all gone through so many challenges and so many different parts of our lives. But perhaps the most challenging part, and we've all faced them, and we all will face them, we have the passing of loved ones. When a friend or a loved one passes, it's always a challenge. And perhaps as a lay chaplain at the hospital, I've maybe experienced a few more deaths than normal, I don't know. But I found that each passing, each person passing, it's unique. There's nothing standard about it. There's nothing automatic about it. It's a very powerful, unique, individual process that no two are alike, in my experience. And this last year, one of those passings had to do with my mother-in-law, Jean. She passed almost, you know, just a month or two before her 100th birthday. She had a great life. And Chris, my wife, and I were fortunate to be with her all these months. We were actually designated caregivers, part of a team prior to COVID. So we were able to continue in that role, spending a lot of time with her, hours and hours. And it was a blessing because we got to know each other so much more. And I got to appreciate a fabulous woman that I wouldn't have otherwise. And her passing was hard. It left a big void in our being. And that was tough. It's interesting. Just a few weeks later, I got called in about midnight on a Friday night to the Grittman family birth center. And a couple had just lost what would be their child. 26-week fetus passed. That was very challenging. I because they were COVID positive, I had to put on the PPE and the N95s, and that kind of course, creates a little bit more of a barrier where you needed to have some degree of intimacy with the parents who were suffering. But we made the best of it. The nurses were fantastic. I said some prayers and I tried to comfort them as best I could. I knew that they're a Christian, and I tried to mold the prayer to align with their beliefs. They asked me to hold the child that was dressed in what would have been its birth suit, its little outfit. And I held the child, lifeless and almost weightless. And I just, I'll never forget that feeling. And I guess it linked me even more to the anguish the parents were feeling at the time. So those two were very powerful for me.
The second question I asked the team members was, what has helped you get through? But before we watch them answer that question, I want to share some of what they've done to help us all get through the pandemic. Right at the outset, the team created a list of all of the members of our community. We sent out a survey and then divvied up the names of the people who didn't respond so that they got a phone call. The pastoral ministry team helped pair folks who indicated an interest up with what we called COVID buddies. And they checked in more carefully with everyone who lived alone or who we thought might need extra support. All of the members of the team had at least a few names on their list. They also hosted a drop-in group for community connections. They hosted the grief group, and they came up with the idea for the community care grants to make it easier and more comfortable for folks who could use a little financial support to get it. Above all, this team kept me sane. When we transitioned to online church, everything I knew about how to do my job went out the window. I felt lost and afraid and completely incompetent. But then the team met, and we were meeting every week or two for the first few months. And together we were able to envision ways to weave love and caring in this drastically altered landscape. It may not have been perfect, but we worked really hard to honor my promise to Jerry that no one would slip through the cracks under what were really incredibly challenging circumstances. So with no further ado, here is what team members had to say in answer to the question, what helped you get through?
It took me a little while to think about that because in some ways I don't feel like I've gotten through it very well. Probably like a lot of us, it comes in fits and spurts, and sometimes I do better and can sort of be at peace with the nature of change. And other times I just want to stomp my foot and pout about the way things are. And so that takes me then back to self-compassion, because there are three elements of self-compassion that have really helped. And the first one is simply to recognize suffering. And this pandemic has created suffering in ways I don't think any of us could have ever even anticipated. So there's suffering involved. And then the second part of self-compassion is universality, in that we are all suffering, right? Common humanity, suffering links us together. And so it reminds me that even though it feels very alone, I actually am not alone in my suffering. And then the third component of self-compassion is mindfulness, and that is simply trying to be present with whatever I'm feeling in the moment, whether it's anger, frustration, longing, grief, the types of things that we've had to compromise and sacrifice. So self-compassion, I would say, has been played a big part. And then, you know, nature, as a pagan, nature is my church. And so trying to be more deliberate and intentional about getting outside and experiencing the healing power of nature.
Stopping and really thinking about the situation helps me a lot. And I realize that just about everybody has the same kind of problems with this. Nobody likes it the way it is. We're all feeling stressed and unhappy about it. So it's not like I'm doing this alone.
I think something that helps soothe it or calm the moment at that moment for me had to do with the spoken word, specifically the sound that comes from words spoken in prayer or a poem. When before Jean passed, in the days leading up to it, we had an opportunity for her to visit with her priest of many, many years. And he shared some words from the Episcopal Book of Common Prayer. And those words were unfamiliar to me. It had to do with the Trinity and Jesus the Savior. And similar words were also shared by a deacon, a local deacon that's gotten very close with Jean, and coming from that Book of Common Prayer. And those words, again, alien to me in so many ways. I don't include the Trinity or Jesus Christ, the Savior, in my own personal prayer. But I had a lot of respect for those words, and I knew they meant so much to Jean. But the way they were shared from the priest and the deacon, how they came across, the tone was more than the specific meaning of the words. There was something deep, something powerful, a love that came through those words that really affected Jean and certainly affected us.
Attending the Zoom service and the small group chat, I was very faithful about that for over a year. I don't tend to do the coffee hours now, but that was especially important. And meeting monthly with the small group facilitators and the lay pastoral ministers was important for me to do. Eating healthy and exercising regularly, that was a goal of mine. I can't say I hit it all the time, but it's what I strive for. And I did a lot of laying on the couch and reading books. That nourishes my soul. So I made sure that happened. And watching old movies.
So as I mentioned, one was walking with friends on the mountain. And then there was a few things I could do for the church community. At some point, we put people in touch in pairs with each other, telephone pairs. And I was able to do a lot there. And at some point I thought, I can at least call people. So I tried, not every day, but often, to just sit on the phone and call a person. And I reached out to some that I didn't know that well, but I knew them some. And we had some nice visits on the phone with each other. At least I hope they got as much out of it as I did.
So many things. I think you could boil it all down to one word, is love, you know, of friends, of family, of self. Taking care of oneself is a kind of love. I found an online yoga practice that I could do at home because I couldn't go to the yoga studio anymore. And it's nice because I can choose how long I want to do it every day. And it's very loving, and it's a way to get centered. And I discovered some things doing that the spinal column that goes through us, that's our central point. And the whole purpose of yoga is to balance one side against the other through that central point, through breathing and through releasing the tension spots. It's really a wonderful way to stay in balance. When I am in balance anyway, sometimes that doesn't work, but. And doing meditations and writing and taking walks And one of my greatest loves that I've discovered during the pandemic that I hadn't before is writing letters to my grandson, which he can read now. So it's really a joy.
When we first installed our pastoral ministers back in 2018, they promised that they would take seriously the trust that was being placed in their hands and that they would serve to the best of their abilities. They said, "We will bear witness to all of what life has to offer, withholding judgment, offering unconditional acceptance and love." And this is really what they have done for us. Our third and final question gets at what they've learned in the process.
So what kind of support are you able to offer others as a lay pastoral minister?
I can offer deep listening. I can hold a space so folks can tell their stories and know that it's a safe place to hold their stories and it will be held. It will not be shared. Going for walks or coffee is good.
Well, I seek to help others. I like to think of myself, and I know I always work at it, trying to be a listener, trying to really listen to what others are sharing in words or actions, trying to be aware of their situation, and as best I can, have some empathy for it. And when I can have a little bit of empathy, I can help provide care and comfort in the best I can. So it's, you know, it's something I always strive for, and I'm not perfect in it, but it's something I really work at and hope I can be welcoming and opening to anybody, regardless of their background. And I guess as a former anthropologists, a lot of different populations I've worked with, from the homeless to Native Americans to all sorts of folks. And I hope I can be open to the wonderful nature of our diverse congregation at our church, because we have so many different voices and experiences. And, you know, there's no uniformity to our group, which is great, other than they're all wonderful people.
Well, right now, I think I'm actually better on the written side of things than the verbal, just because of the communication issues. So I've been making some little, I call them tea party cards, but I have a picture of a teapot on the front and a teacup that I attach a tea bag to inside, and then I write out little things that I might talk about with whoever if we were really having tea together. And I just because no matter how electronic we are these days, it's still always fun to get real mail.
The grief around animals is what we call disenfranchised in our community, not just our community, but in community at large. I mean that in societal. And so when a person anticipates losing an animal, has lost an animal, has childhood experiences of grief and loss around animals, those often aren't validated and seen as real losses. And so an animal chaplain provides that pastoral ear of simply being present and holding space and providing validation and connection around all of the experiences that come with the loss of beloved parts of our family. And it can also be grief around loss of habitat and species extinction. It doesn't have to just be our companion animals, but again, sort of a nature connected type of grief as well.
Yeah, just lovingly listening, unconditional, non-judgmental, and just being there when people need to let go.
I think I have learned to listen to people and not to just always give advice or not to tell them what to do. Because I think a lot of people just need to unburden them sometimes and need somebody there and a listening ear.
We are so lucky. This is just such an amazing group of humans. You know, I am good at pastoral care and I love being your minister, but there's only one of me. And the benefit of having a team of such fantastic humans is that you can call on the person you most need to talk to. Sometimes we intuitively know we need a little tough love. Sometimes we need soft and warm and sympathetic. Sometimes we need the person who will make us laugh. There's nothing more healing or more helpful or more hopeful than being heard and held by caring, non-judgmental, wise humans. I am so grateful to each and every one of our pastoral ministers. Their service has strengthened us as individuals and as a community. And I also know that they've received gifts and blessings as they've engaged in this holy work. So as always, deep gratitude to each of you. Thank you for moving out of your comfort zone and letting me interview for today's service. I know it was hard for some of you. Above all, thank you for holding the pastoral ministry of this community, this congregation, with so much grace and faithfulness and love. You are the best, and I love you all. So be it, and so may it be. Let's sing together again. This is Comfort Me. Thank you. Our closing today is a poem that Fran Rodriguez wrote. Fran, take it away.
When a cold wind blows out the light and all you see is darkness, I'll be there to hold your hands, to hear your words, to light the chalice until you see your path. It was always there waiting for you to see, waiting for you to be sure-footed once again. I'll be there until you find that welling up within is the strength unique and worthy that defines your being. Until then, we will light the chalice together, and I'll be there.
Let's join in our song. There is a love holding me. There is a love holding all that I love. There is a love holding on. I rest in this love. Let's go ahead and blow out or snuff our chalice or our candle. We extinguish this chalice that it might glow gently in our hearts. May it light our path as we leave this place. May it guide our way until we are together again. You know, sometimes the love that holds us, you need it to wear skin. And that's the essence of pastoral ministry. And there are so many people who do this for each other, people who are on the team and beyond. All of the ways that we weave love bring beauty and grace and kindness into the world. So keep weaving. It's good to see you all. Deep gratitude for each and every one of you. Those of you who don't usually stay for coffee hour, you can go in peace and we'll see you next week. And folks who want to stay around, we'll put you in breakout rooms in just a moment.